design, and I've done mostly artwork, but I do have a day job doing research holography, making holographic optical diffusers. So it's a really real treat to be able to be here and be back involved in the art end of holography. The name of my paper is The Visual Language and Technique in the Creative Holographic Domain. The language of art describes the palette of techniques used for the expression of content. These techniques offer layers of creative possibilities for analog, digital, and emerging hybrid formats for holographic artistic expression. This paper describes the creative techniques used in my analog holographic artwork. It's presented as it evolved within the historical context. The limitations and opportunities of studio time, recording materials, and processing regimes are discussed as elements which are relevant to the evolution of these works. Early techniques associated with hands-on holography are described, and the relation to content is explored. My background in art originated in photography, and the history of creative possibilities in photography evolved in sync with the technical developments in a similar way to that of holography. One can trace the evolution from the non-permanent images of the camera Lucida from the early 1800s through the permanent recording of daguerreotypes to the Kodak box camera. In photography, we now have digital imaging, and each new technical development expands the dialogue between the medium and the creative use of it. The technical and formal creative languages develop in sync. The late 70s, enthusiasm and youthful exuberance. My initial holographic education in the late 70s took place in Chicago at the little-known Fine Arts Research and Holographic Center. The School of Holography chose not to integrate into the larger international community, as evidenced by their absence at conferences. However, this school did provide a very good technical platform for many of its students, and those students include Tom Svekovich, Stephen Smith, Doug Tyler, Ed Wesley, and me. It was an exciting time for a bunch of wild young artists. Long-term friendships and careers sprang from this intense time in our field's history. This was also edging onto the time for the beginning of the Lake Forest symposiums and TJ's successful efforts to coalesce a professional field from so many disparate parts. The limited studio lab time at Fine Arts Research encouraged the hands-on exploration of the volume, single-beam Dinosuk reflection, and inline transmission holograms. Advanced classes introduced the master transfer techniques. During this time at Fine Arts, my fellow students and I were marveling at our 2x2-inch holograms created on small sand isolation tables, like shown here. At this early stage, it was really 3D photography that I was seeking. It was the replication of objects that we worked so hard to create, given the technical limitations of the day. We had terrible film, really dim, inefficient film, bad photochemistry, and no good playback lights. The common approach then to image making was to work from found objects and sculptures created from plaster castings. The approach revealed to us 3D virtual images, as well as images that extended through the film plane. After a few months of just trying to get a bright image, our collective efforts took a turn. Something interesting started to happen. Several of us became less concerned with replication and more interested in the creating options available with the visual palette. Especially intriguing were the wonders of the upside-down and inside-out pseudoscopic image and its movement out in front of the film plane. Flipped over holograms of little coins and castings and found objects lost their identifiable form and evolved into semi-transparent, nebulous, kinetic, dimensional sculptures made out of light. Economic necessity limited us to film rather than glass, which allowed us to cut up images and making it possible to reposition sections of images and overlap pseudoscopic and virtual images collage style. Somebody want to wake Frank up? Okay. You've been working really hard. It's okay. That's all right. No, it really is. Okay. Evergreen State College. Oh, no, don't leave. Evergreen State College, Olympia, Washington. In 1981, I returned to school to obtain my arts degree at Evergreen State College. The institution was well equipped with a holography lab containing a 50 milliwatt helium neon laser, an NRC table, and an Edelon. This lab was considered top of the line for an artist to have access to in the 1980s. At that time, the only other person using the lab was art professor Young Harville. I was very fortunate to receive mentoring from him for my independent study. Harville was a brilliant art teacher at the college and one of the few people I know who has showed me that you can embrace both the art and technical world without compromising your vision in either. Harville went on from there to Stanford University and was one of the original inventors of macromedia. I continued my work at Evergreen State College using the Dennis-Hook single beam reflection technique. Access to unlimited studio lab time allowed me to immerse myself. Still appealing to me was the immediacy of the simple optical setup, which allowed for experimentation with little downtime. The single beam technique felt spontaneous, as it was not fragmented by the time constraints of resetting the optics for the two-step transfers. A major advancement occurred at this time. This is about 1980-81, which was the introduction of the new high-density AGFA recording materials. Coupling this HD film with pyrochrome processing made the creation of bright holograms with huge dynamic range easy to create. No more studio time spent just trying to get an image, which was really what a lot of people did for a very long time, especially with reflection work. Let's see here. Where am I? Theme-oriented works predominated for me during this time. In the series place settings, I incorporated what I ended up calling light blocks. These fork-shaped stencils were placed on the surface of the film, blocking the reference and object beam. This created 2D graphics on the film plane and also cast shadows into the scene as well. At this time, the limiting factor within the X and Y dimensions of the hologram was the reference object beam being blocked out by the film edge. By framing finished works smaller than the original recording area on the film, the scene would appear to extend under the frame and out beyond the physical dimension of the finished piece. This is when I began to utilize and explore the possibilities of the aperture boundaries of holograms. Pseudoscopy and the movement inherent with real images had already captivated my attention and defined for me a new way of thinking about the spatial domain. The pseudoscopic view of the 2D shadows cast into an image scene created real images of three-dimensional shadows, or what I called shadow forms, as shown here. These fork shapes are just three-dimensional shadows that extend out beyond the edges of that mat board. During this time at Evergreen College, my art history courses and other art explorations brought me into contact with the work of the early 20th century modern art movement and the Russian avant-garde. The Russian avant-garde artists, and in particular the artist Lyuba Popova and her, quote, eloquent examples of pure spatial articulation defined by the materials, end quote, were a great source of inspiration to me. My interest in their questions about spatial rendering had brought about my own transition into eliminating the identifiable object altogether. This was for me the beginning of rendering the deconstruction of holographic space. Deconstructing and reassimilation of geometric forms in holographic space became the focus of my arts degree. My exploration now included using light blocks, creating three-dimensional shadow forms, and combining virtual and pseudoscopic images with a basic non-objective approach, as shown in this hologram. Most of these holograms are 8x10, 9x12, and the largest that you'll see are 30x40 centimeter until we get into some panels. Okay. Exposure controlled color. Although my technical understanding of optics was limited, my background in black and white photography provided solid darkroom processing skills. The dynamic range of the new HD film in combination with Kodak D19 or pyrochrome and reversal bleach processing made it possible to produce up to three colors and color mixing just from variations in the exposure times. The exposure-controlled color technique was seldom used in pseudocolor holography, which at that time was focused on pre-swelling. The subtle color shifts enhanced by the emulsion collapse of the overlapping exposed areas produced an extended palette of flowing colors that were enhanced or minimized by areas of greater or lesser exposure. This hologram is on film, and the colors are only varied by varying the exposure. That's it. The palette of possibilities for the holograms was extended by recording one scene in the space left by light blocking the reference object beam from another previously recorded scene. This simple technical approach to holography allowed for the possibilities that layers of textures and colors could be embedded within each other or intersect in three-dimensional space in a way that was not physically possible. Shadow forms and pseudoscopic elements in the reflection film hologram studies shown are example of this exploration. These holograms were created in 1983. They all have names and everything, but I'm trying to hurry. So that's one of the images, and this is the other one, which I really still really quite like. They're just little film holograms, about 8x10. Okay, now I have a slide I'm gonna miss because I'm very concerned. I've been warned about time, so maybe I can talk about that later. Okay, the Holographic Studio Limited Artist in Resident Program. In 1985, Global Images hired me to design the Holographic Studio in Vancouver, British Columbia. Global Images was owned by Walter Clark. Mr. Clark was one of the more colorful and generous supporters of art holography in the 80s and 90s. Global set up an artist-in-resident program at the lab and commissioned several art holographers such as Rudy Burkout and Dan Switzer to produce holograms. Global assembled one of the most valuable holographic art collections from that time period. Global appointed me to run the AIR program, which gave me complete and unlimited access to the studio between visiting artists. During this time, I continued working in reflection mode, utilizing single-beam Dinosuk techniques and still avoiding the transfer process. The Z-axis series. This is in the early 1980s. Extending the process, the split-beam reflection technique, the aperture boundaries started to limit my expression and the limitations became more apparent. With this technique, the shadowing created by the 45-degree angled reference object beam prevented me from exploring deep into the Z-axis. My ideas were limited as the deeper the scene became, the more limited the illumination arena became. The creative potential to record deep into the Z-axis was now extended by incorporating additional object illumination beams during recording to illuminate layers of non-objective scenes behind a film plane. The spatial possibilities resulting from the Dinosuk test technique in combination with additional object beams or split-beam reflection holography allowed for more depth in the holograms without compromising the immediacy of the process. A series of pseudocolor reflection holograms titled Z-axis was the result. An example from this art is shown here. This is the same, this again is the same color work where this is the same hologram and it has two different lights, one light coming in at one angle and another light coming in at a completely opposite angle. And it generates the two-color image. This is called Safe Place to Dream, and I made this after returning from China in 1985 and working with Dr. Xu, and it has bamboo in it, and it was my sort of homage piece to my experience here. Precise color control. Okay. In order to maintain resolution in the deeper holograms, it was necessary to move from the wideband reversal bleach chemical process into a more wavelength selective process, which allowed for precise pseudocolor control. As well, it was time to create colors based on their emotional messages. It was also important to hold these precise colors and maintain the best resolution in the depth axis when the final image holograms were illuminated. The method of the day for this type of color control was to pre-swell the emulsion with triethanolamine. This process offered tighter resolution than the broadband process I had been using. This gave me the ability to do deeper and deeper scenes which held their visual integrity. Examples are shown in the 30 by 40 centimeter glass reflection hologram, Healing for Broken Hearts. This image was created in 1986. The holograms from the Z-axis series are approximately 18 inches deep and extend out in front of the film plane about 5 inches. Sorry, there's the hologram. There's one image of it. And those are two views of that same hologram. Viewer participation. The Z-axis series was designed to be installed or shown on plinths. This method of display allowed viewers to walk around the holograms and look into them from many perspectives. The images became somewhat kinetic as impressions were revealed or disappeared by utilizing the aperture boundaries and creating content zones which projected from the holograms depending on the viewing point. Selective exposure by masking out the film surface with light blocks made it possible to embed or interpenetrate dimensional space within a separate dimensional space. The intersection of scenes and objects from different exposures could intersect in 3D space in a way that was not possible physically in reality. And this is another scene. It's very hard to tell, of course, with these, but there's all these different layers. They go down very, very deep in the hologram, and they're at different angles. And you look at one, and it looks like it's going to completely intersect with the one that's below it, but of course they don't. And that's that beauty of the interpenetrating of those different dimensions. Okay, where am I here? And this is just a few of the pieces from the Z-axis series. And I completed that work in the 80s, around this time, 1986. Okay, transfer holography. My work with the Denisuk technique reached a plateau in the mid-1980s. At that time, I had the opportunity to begin a 7-year collaboration with artist Sidney Dinsmore. My explorations shifted, and although still concentrated on reflection holography, my work was now based on transferring Ruby Pulse laser masters into pseudocolor reflection figurative H2s. And Sidney and I also created a series of banners, and these banners were used in our installations. Oops. Oh, okay. And they were great for framing in the pieces and things like that. Okay, 3031. Okay. We did a series called Is This What You Want? And there were these very lovely figure studies, and there were several of these. And this is just an example of three of them. This collaboration, oops, I'm supposed to be back here still. Okay. This collaborative process added another dynamic to the art making that was absent with my solo works. This period of art creation was rich, fulfilling, great fun, and the master to transfer holography did, of course, open up avenues of expression not possible with the more immediate Denisuk style. The figurative works created during this collaboration were extensions of the experimental exploration of the works that preceded it. Since I was now transferring images, it was important to keep in mind how easily the three-dimensional effect can collapse if the projected or real image intersects with the edges of the frame. This was considered at both the mastering and in particular during the transferring stage. Forming content. This work emphasized the content zones created by the aperture boundaries of the master H1 to the transfer H2. And we use this as a method of emphasis for the narrative of the artworks. An example of this is shown here. This is titled Choice, What Choice? The hologram is the image in the middle. The two little ones on the side I'll explain. This 30 by 40 centimeter reflection hologram is created from two separate masters designed to play back to two different locations within the viewer's space, hence a two-channel hologram. This two-channel or double exposure hologram describes the myriad of emotions that we literally embody. This image was best expressed by revealing the two separate states of mind from two different viewing zones, and then gradually, via viewer movement through the viewing space, revealing the overlap and fusion of the two images, or the two states of being. A simple double exposure would not have worked for this. It required the projection into the viewer's space of the separate images and the fusion as well. So the image on the left you would see first, and then you'd gradually see the two intersect, and then as you move to the right, you would just have the figure on the right. Okay, 34. The content zone technique was also used for the multiple exposure panels, Untitled and Rumors. These panels were made up of several images. The original H1 masters were two-channel, and these were transferred as double exposures into the final holograms. We offset the H1s in order to utilize the aperture boundaries and content zone projected images to emphasize the meaning of the work. Rumors extends our exploration of body language, and this piece is about the manner in which we watch a silent conversation from across a room and yet are able to decipher by the subtle but revealing actions of the body in space. And this piece is, I need video of this. This panel is about 8 feet long, and it's actually made up of about 44 different images. And as you walk by it, they move and shift and turn. And the further away from the piece you get, the less you have to move, of course. So, you know, if you're right up in front of it, you can look at the shifting and moving in each panel. But if you're across the room, you basically just have to move a little bit. And it was one of my favorite pieces. The other one was This was another one that we did. This was just called the Untitled Panel, and the main hologram is at the top, and underneath that is an example of what you would see from the right view. This piece is about 4 feet long and about 14 inches high. Color control options. This body of work drew upon all available color control techniques for a single laser wavelength, non-panchromatic film regime. Decisions were based on the expression or content of the images and the type of color they needed. We utilized reversal bleach wideband processing for the figure on the left, triethanolamine narrowband processing for the panels, the panel in the middle, and I even set up the Julie Walker's MIT in situ color control tank, which I think there's only about three in the world, and that was used for the large panel rumors. Decisions on the technical approach to color control were based on the content message of the individual holograms. The Dinsmore-Crenshaw collaboration ended in the mid-1990s, but our great lifelong friendship continues. The collaborative process is rich, full, and very democratic. And that's just a few little samples. I'm getting to the end. Okay. Oops. 40. Open aperture and reductions. Okay, optically reducing open aperture images. Now we're getting into the 90s. We're ahead here. We're at the end of the 90s. Laser transmission masters are generally copied or transferred into an H2 via a collimating optic in order to reserve the scale and proportion of the image being transferred. Transferring a transmission image into a transmission copy without an interim optic between the H1 and H2, like a slit optic, for instance, will create an open aperture transfer. The image transferred in this way will diffract into a spectral blur upon playback with white light. This spectral effect can be used to create a color field which has the look and feel of veils of luminous spectra. This effect has been used to create the color field in the image seen. It's the far left of the bottom image. That's basically the face in the middle transferred in without any kind of an optic. So it creates that situation. In the center of the image of the hologram, a condensing lens had been utilized during recording between the master and the H2 to create an optical reduction of the transferred image from the pulse master. Optically reducing an open aperture image and positioning the film at the plane will keep it from dispersing into its spectral colors. So my face in that, it's only about 5 inches, it's about 7 inches tall. No, it's about 6x4. So it's quite small. It's been optically reduced. Okay, and now incorporating real objects. Objects such as feathers were attached to the back of the holograms in this series, blocking the playback light and casting shadows into the image. The feathers blocking the playback light, of course, also interrupted the reconstruction of the image where the feathers blocked the light, adding an interesting void zone in the holograms. In some ways, this addition of the object into the final hologram refers back full circle to my early explorations of the media where only the object was of significance. And this is another image from that. This is an optically reduced achromat. It's about 7 by 5 or something like that. It's small, and it has the feather in it. Okay, I'm just about done here. Off-the-shelf holography. Starting around the year 2000, my creative explorations continued in a less demanding but still satisfying vein. Off-the-shelf materials, embossing films, and a simple approach to working with light has informed my recent artwork. Kinetic color and holographic diffraction effects, lack of access to an art studio lab, and the demands of a complicated domestic life guided my transition back to material object where this exploration started. I refer to this as my kitchen table series. The embossed holographic foils are used in combination with hardware store flashing and other materials, other easy-to-obtain elements to create installation pieces such as the one shown. This piece here is a piece I just installed in at the end of 2007, beginning of 2008, and it is a piece that I created in memory, a memorial piece to the memory of early art holographer Jerry Pethick. Hand cutting the metal flashing and applying diffraction grating foils took place at my kitchen table after my day job and domestic duties were done. So that's a piece to Jerry Pethick, and maybe we can talk about who he is tonight for people that don't know. He was very significant in the early days of art holography. So my conclusion is that visual or formal language serves as a vehicle or guidepost for passing along information and options to artists. It's important to identify and archive the myriad of creative options available and define and archive the language used to describe these options. We are witnessing the separation of the origination of content and the final production or printing of the hologram with the amazing new digital systems. As these new technologies and imaging opportunities evolve, it's important for artists to pass on the existing creative options discovered over many decades of creating holographic art. Otherwise, some venues of expression will be lost to a new generation of artists who are not present in the optics lab, hands-on where the holograms take form. And there was a couple of references there. Oh, one thing I should mention is the Pulse Masters were made with great technical support by Fred Unterseer and Rebecca Diem, and some with Hans Bielkelgen. So I have to thank Lita Light Architectural Products. That's the company I work for, and I have a research job there, and they're wonderful about letting me come to things like this and supporting me to do it. I have flex time and all sorts of great things like a steady paycheck, so that's my day job. I'd like to thank TJ for creating an international community of holographers. This is TJ in Wales. We went around and looked at all these ancient sites and things for 2 or 3 days after the last conference, but he was most delighted to find the American donut stand where he could get a hot dog. And I'd like to thank the International Holography Fund who provided grants for artists to attend, TJ, Frank Fan, and Dynasty Wang for their support of the art holography community. And that's a picture from Wales, and I've titled that Holographic Community Bonding Ritual. So that's it. Thank you.